اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم. Brothers and sisters, مؤمنين and مؤمنات, أحبتي في الله, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين, بارئ الخلائق أجمعين, فاطر السماوات والأرضين, باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين, وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا العبد المؤيد والرسول المسدد المصطفى الأمجاد أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين, لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين, روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفداء. صلى الإله على سلالة أحمد, صلى الإله على سلالة أحمد أهل الكرم, من كان سلمه سلم أو كان حربهم ندم. يرضى الإله إذا رضوا وبكل ما حكموا حكام. خلق المهيمن نورهم, خلق المهيمن نورهم من قبل أن برأ النسام. لولا هدايتهم لما عرف السبيل ولا علم.
بسيط الله الصلوات.
كثر الشك والخلاف وكل يدعي الفوز بالصراط السوي, فاعتصامي بلا إله سواه ثم حبي لأحمد وعلي. فاز كلب بحب أصحاب كهفي, فاز كلب بحب أصحاب كهفي, كيف أشقى بحب آل النبي.
صلوات على محمد.
Alhamdulillah
for this great opportunity we all have to attend a majlis of millions of majalis, thousands and hundreds of thousands of majalis that are held now in all around the world in these 2-3 days to show respect and wilaya and ma'rifa to Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to include among true followers and lovers of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam and true followers of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. Indeed, it's such a difficult job when it comes to Amir al-Mu'mineen to speak. And when you come here and you want to speak, if any kind of contribution you want to have to this majlis, your presence, your recitation, mashallah, brother recited a very beautiful recitation. It was honestly one of the best recitations I've ever heard in my life. When it is the majlis of Amir al-Mu'mineen, everyone wants to have the best contribution to majlis. And when I want to speak, actually it is very difficult because of the great stage and maqam Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam has. When you want to speak, you are just bewildered by the high qualities of this man, the man who raised the bar so high that no one can reach to his qualities and morals. Actually, when you want to speak about Amir al-Mu'mineen, it's like you are beside a massive ocean and you want to take a handful, but you try to take that handful in the best way and at least give this kind of contribution to your faith, to your Imam alayhi salam, in the best manner. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to observe and consider this majlis among those majalis who he and also Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam has their mercy and their attention to these majlis, inshallah. Actually, I was thinking that what topic will do justice to the maqam of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, to speak about his history, to speak about his fada'il. But whenever I want to speak about Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, I reach to this conclusion that we don't have any hadith or fada'il higher than this one, as it is famous as Hadith al-Saqalain. مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا لَن تَظِلُّ أَبَدًا. This is the highest fada'il for Amir al-Mu'min. I don't want to say that the other fada'ils, to diminish the value of those fada'il, the miracles, everything that they had, their moral qualities, but this hadith, when Prophet of Islam sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam recites salawat, when Prophet of Islam wants to introduce a fadila which will remain in the memory of all Muslims, regardless of their sect and their faith or their belief or their theological school, this hadith, Prophet knew that this will remain. And Prophet has the highest levels of intellect and reason, and he knew what to say to remain in the history and to be reverberated by people age by age. He said, "Inni tarakum fikum al-thaqalain kitab Allah wa itrati." So what is the most important figure of Ahlul Bayt? The itra, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا لَن تَظِلُّ أَبَدًا. Now I want to make this kind of connection between Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam and Quran in a new way. And inshallah, I ask you to ponder and think about it and see how is this approach, whether it appeals to you or you want to add something. I will also benefit your comments. But actually, when we say مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا لَن تَظِلُّ أَبَدًا, Ahlul Bayt and Qur'an are two precious things. If you resort and try to benefit from both of them at the same time, then you won't gone astray. But if you want just to have Al-Itra, not Qur'an, then you are not on the path of Rasulullah. If you want just to take Quran and say Quran is enough for me, then again you are not on the path of Rasulullah. So what we can do to benefit from this? Usually when we have Quranic studies, and unfortunately these types of Quranic studies just influence from academic way of Quranic studies, either it is in a synchronic way or, as they say, diachronic way, means either it is historical or synchronic. Sometimes when you want to study Quran, you say, okay, what is the case of revelation? What is the occasion of revelation of this verse? When this happened, what was the story? Who were the, for example, munafiqeen in this verse? Who were mu'mineen in this verse? What happened? This is the history of Quran. Many of us are interested in that, and that is good. This is the main way of doing tafsir, at-tafsir al-tarikhi, historical tafsir. Sometimes, for example, you say, do we have any, for example, verse or concept related to this verse of Quran in the previous books, like in Bible, Old Testament, New Testament? This is kind of historical approach towards the tafsir of Quran. Sometimes you have a synchronic approach towards tafsir of Quran. You don't care when this verse was revealed or what is the background of this in pre-Islamic Arabic in the ignorance era. You don't care about that. What you do, you want to know what is the relation of the verbs, words, vocabularies of the Quran with one another. For example, you say why Meccan verses are shorter than Medinan verses. We have Makki and Madani. Makki surahs usually have shorter verses. They have a special rhyming. But in Medinan verses and surahs, you see that they are longer. Another question, sometimes you say, okay, this verb or this word in the Quran, does it have origin in other languages, in Aramaic, in Akkadian, or in Hebrew, or no? All the words of Quran are in Arabic. Is there any problem with that or not? Sometimes you say, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one verse says Musa wa Harun, in another says Haruna wa Musa. Why they are different? So actually, when you study this way, you don't talk about the history of the Quran or history of revelation, when it was revealed. You want to understand the text of Quran, regardless of the history. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one verse says Tur Sayna, in the other says Tur Sinin? When they are the same, why they look different or they are pronounced in different ways? But actually, all these discussions are valuable and all of them are great. But what we need, and I want just to give an example of this type of study tonight, is to practice understanding Quran based on the life of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. I sometimes say I feel pity for those some Muslims and narrators when they were asking Imams alayhim as-salam about, for example, the meaning of Quran. For example, they would go to Imams alayhim as-salam and say, oh Imam, what is the meaning of this verse? Imam would say, yes, this is the meaning. Another time he would go and asking about the history of the verse, oh Imam, when this verse was revealed and who are these people? Imam would say, so this is exactly those two types of Quranic studies, historical or synchronic. But the third way that I really feel pity why those Muslims did not ask Imams alayhim as-salam, they could ask Imam, oh Imam, how can I implement this verse in my life? How do you benefit from this verse in your life? Imam alayhi salam would answer to this, and now we would know the knowledge of Quran in its original way. The Quran is a book of guidance. If you know the history of Quran, the words of the Quran, the etymology of the words of Quran. Okay, this is one discussion. But if you know, you don't know how to implement this verse in your life, what is the benefit for you? So that was the best question they could ask Imams alayhim as-salam. Now, inshallah, I want to speak about one of the qualities of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam based on some verses of Quran. And we read these verses, I will translate them, and after that we'll see how Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam in his life manifested the teachings and the concepts in these verses. In Surah As-Saff we read and I recite,
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سبح لله ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا لم تقولون ما لا تفعلون كبر مقتا عند الله أن تقولوا ما لا تفعلون.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these few verses introduces one of the most important qualities of mu'min people. First of all, he starts with glorification of himself. سبح لله ما في السماوات والأرض. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is glorified by everything that exists in the skies, in the heavens and earth. Then immediately Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes, this is very strange. After glorification, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes to condemning and reproaching some people. Ya ayyuha allatheena amanu lima taquluna ma la taf'alun. O those who believe, why you say something which you do not? Which you do not perform in your life, which you do not act based on your sayings. لِمَ تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَن تَقُولُوا مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. This is a great sin before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you say something which you do not do. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِهِ كَأَنَّهُمْ بُنْيَانٌ مَرْسُوسٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those people who do jihad. Jihad has different types. Who are fighting and who are spending their lives and their money and their energy for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. كَأَنَّهُمْ بُنْيَانٌ مَرْسُوسٌ. Like they are strong buildings and walls. Solid structures. Amir al-Mu'min alayhi salam, we don't need to know when this verse was revealed. What is the history? It is a part of his tafsir. But what we need to do is to find the examples that Amir al-Mu'min alayhi salam manifest in his life regarding these verses. What are those examples? There are quite strange examples that happened in the life of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. One day, as you know, we have a supplication that sometimes we recite in the sajda, when we prostrate, the last sajda of our salat. What do we say? We say, Allahumma inni, the continuation of the dua is this, وَالْإِسْتِعْدَادَ لِلْمَوْتِ قَبْلَ حُلُولِ الْفَوْتِ. O Allah, I ask you to give me the ability to get prepared for death before the death comes to me. وَالْإِسْتِعْدَادَ لِلْمَوْتِ قَبْلَ حُلُولِ الْفَوْتِ. Before I cannot do anything else. Because the day of judgment is يَوْمُ the day of reward and punishment, not the day of amal. It is not the day of action. You cannot do anything. When you die, you cannot add to your thawab or to your sins. That word is the world of punishment and reward. One day, one man asked Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, "Oh Imam, mal isti'dad lil-maut? What is the meaning of preparation for death?" Imam alayhi salam said three things. Most of us consider two of them, but forget the third one. And the main problem is with the third one. قَالَ أَدَاءُ الْفَرَائِضِ The first one is performing your wajibat, performing your obligation. Obligation, it doesn't mean that everything that is written in Tawzihul Masail. Obligation, which means that anything that is in need of your community. Many of us, when it reaches to the needs of community, in our centers, in our masajid, we say, okay, I don't come to, for example, mosque tonight, this is mustahab. But if you know that by your not coming to majlis, the majlis, mosque, will be weakened, will lose, and people will lose their unity. So this is itself is a kind of sin. Because you know that if you do not come to masjid, then who is going to come? If you do not meet your friend, if you do not visit your parents, then who is going? So there are some actions which are not mentioned as wajib in Risala or in the books, but actually they are considered wajib for us. The second one, wajtinabul maharim, to refrain from haram. And the third one, wal ishtimal ala al makarim, to have makarim ul akhlaq, to have noble qualities, moral qualities, and not to harbor any bad qualities or bad intention towards anyone and towards ourselves. Because sometimes we don't have bad intention about other people, but you see we harm ourselves by sinning. Wal ishtimal ala al makarim. Then Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, when this person asked what is the preparation of death, and Imam alayhi salam explained these three conditions, Imam alayhi salam said, ثُمَّ لَا يُبَالِي ثُمَّ لَا يُبَالِي إِنْ وَقَعَ عَلَى الْمَوْتِ أَوْ وَقَعَ الْمَوْتُ عَلَيْهِ Such person who has these three qualities, he doesn't care whether death comes to him or he is going to welcome death. And then Imam alayhi salam continues, والله ما يبالي ابن أبي طالب إن وقع على الموت أو وقع الموت عليه. By Allah, the son of Abi Talib is not scared whether, doesn't care whether the death coming towards him or he is going towards this, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this example of perseverance, being resistant in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Amirul Mu'mineen, sometimes there were examples that are very interesting even for me when I was reading these examples. For example, it is in Manaqib ibn Shahrashub, which is one of the famous books of Manaqib and Fazail, and also in historical books is a good source for that. كان أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام يطوف بين الصفين بالصفين في غلالة. On the battle of Siffin, Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam was checking the ranks of the arm of his army. But he had a simple shirt on him, not armor. When Imam Hassan alayhi salam saw this, that Amir al-Mu'minin doesn't wear armor and just shirt, said to Imam Ali alayhi salam, مَا هَذَا زِيُّ الْحَرْبِ Ya Ali, O father, this is not the way that people come to war. You have to wear your armor now. Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam says, Ya Bunayya, inna abaka la yubali waqa'a ala al-maut aw waqa'a al-mautu alayhi. Your father is not scared of death, whether the death coming towards him or he is going towards death. Wa kana alayhi salam yaqul, And Imam Ali alayhi salam repeatedly was saying this sentence, مَا يَنْتَذِرُ أَشْقَاهَا أَنْ يَخْذِبَهَا مِنْ فَوْقِهَا بِدَمٍ. What has made that wicked man to come and dye my hair, my beard, with the blood of my head? So for the sake of Allah, you see the best example of Bunyanun Marsus, Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam. There is also another example. As you know, Amirul Mu'mineen had a slave, a servant, Qambar. One day this Qambar was walking behind Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam from far and controlling and trying to act like entourage and bodyguard. Amirul Mu'mineen saw him, said, what are you doing, Qambar? Qambar said, جِئْتُ لِأَمْشِي خَلْفَكَ. I came just walking behind you, nothing. But then he continues, he says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, I don't want to have a bad conjecture, inshallah nothing happens, but إِنَّ النَّاسِ كَمَا تَرَاهُمْ. People are the way you see, means you have many enemies. فَخِفْتُ عَلَيْكَ. I thought maybe something going to happen for you. قَالَ وَيْحَكَ. What happened to you, Qambar? أَمْ مِنْ أَهْلِ السَّمَاءِ تَحْرِسُنِي أَمْ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ. Are you protecting me from inhabitants of the sky or inhabitants of the earth? Qambar said, you know, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, بَلْ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ, from inhabitants of the earth, from the people of Kufa. Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam said, إِنَّ أَهْلَ الْأَرْضِ لَا يَسْتَتِئُونَ بِي شَيْءٍ. Don't worry. People of the earth, they cannot reach to me if they want to fight me, of course. They cannot reach to me, O Qambar. إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَالَ. Except when there is a permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَرْجِ. I don't want to accompany me and coming after me. Go. So you see, Amirul Mu'mineen repeatedly was telling that, first of all, he wanted to say, I know by the knowledge of Imama, by God-given knowledge of Imama, that when I am going to die and I know exactly who is going to kill me. And at the same time he wanted to say, in the path of Allah, you have to be perseverant. Brother honey, how much time do I have? Almost finished. Alhamdulillah, ala jami'i ni'amihi. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all His blessing over us and all His bounties, especially this blessing that we are here and we are able to offer our contribution to the Majlis of Amirul Mu'mineen by our presence, by the salawats and the zikrs that we recite. By everything that we have, we try to help the community and have the best majlis for Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we ask Him to bless our souls and our bodies and our souls with His mercy because of being in this majlis. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to heal all those who are ill. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send His mercy and blessing to the souls of those who have died, parents and grandparents, those who taught us this beautiful religion, this faith, and to our teachers who have died and taught us the right path of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. Wa akhiru da'wana an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa alihi at-tahirin.